Louisiana.
I'm a late bloomer, 3 year on the scene. 20 racks don't feel like nothing to me. Cape on the streets, it turned me to a beast. Invisible set diamonds hugging my piece. But me for a show, I need 80 at least. I want the smoke, ain't no keeping the peace. Toronto, you useless, you don't got a pole. Warm that boy up, he got shot in the cold. 30 rounds in the clip, let it unload. I f***ed up, chop it right out of Vogue. 20, I'm a first VK.
Hey guys, welcome back to Bum Anime. It's
Big Boy Summer here
and Ruka. Now let's get into episode 8 of Darwin's Game.
So, like, first things first, we got a little bit more of a backstory about Rouge and his sort of motivations as to why he hated Wang so much. Because remember last time when we spoke about how the florist, he said he couldn't forgive but didn't show him any hostilities, but that mention of Wang and he was ready to pounce from.
Yeah, that's right. He definitely did. But it kind of makes you wonder, what was he doing while his brother was getting chopped up? It makes me feel like he wasn't in Darwin's game at the moment and he probably just sat there cowering and he's probably ashamed of himself.
Thus saying that, do you think that the brother was the reason why he got into Darwin's game? Because that Shuka took the phone from her dad and got into the game.
Mm.
Did he take his brother's phone and get into the game or some other sort of mechanism?
Yeah, I do definitely think that that's his motivation in some way or another. You know, I'm thinking now that Rouge's power is probably not a useless power. I've been kind of calling it a useless power, a useless sigil. But I've sort of come to the conclusion that there probably isn't any really rubbish sigils out there that can't be changed or adapted.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking that his sigil progression could be changing people's perception of reality.
Okay, that's a bit of a stretch. I'll bite. Go on.
Okay, well, he has the ability to tell who is telling the truth and who is lying.
Yes.
And when we were looking, I know this is a totally different character, but when we were looking at Sui and Sota.
Yes.
Well, actually, Sui in particular, she took all the water out of Shuka and Shuka Etel's clothing. And then I think it was Rouge who said, oh, you could actually use that to remove all the moisture out of someone's body.
Yes.
So then if you can tell who's telling the truth and who's telling a lie, why wouldn't you be able to mess with that? Mess with the person's perception of what is real and what is fake?
Well, I have a similar point on that, but it's not quite as godlike OP as that. It's more along the lines of, I think he said something about him thinking that his power was useless because all he can't tell what's in their heads. He can only tell if it's a lie or not. And I thought that was a bit of foreshadowing into, like, maybe powers evolving and his power will evolve into mind reading and something along those whole telepathic sort of ways, like reading aura. Well, not as bad as Kyoda's reading auras, but like reading people's thoughts, and maybe he can implant thoughts as well. That's what I was sort of thinking.
That's perception, messing with their perception, not necessarily messing with what is real or fake, but messing with their perception.
But we all know perception is reality.
Exactly.
Mm.
So I'm looking forward to seeing something more from Rouge because he's not really giving me anything right now. He's not that clever. His sigil isn't that great. What? And I just can't see a place for him right now.
Did you say he's not that clever, fam? He had the drop on bloody Kaname. He's the only character in the whole show to have the drop on Kaname.
Complete luck. Because if the florist hadn't laid all those traps, I just don't think that would have happened.
But he had was cornered. It doesn't matter, it's Darwin's game. That was the situation he was in and he had to
drop it. Doesn't make him smart.
He could drive a car really fast.
Wow.
He's good with guns and he knows people with weaponry. He's useful. I'm not saying he's smart, I'm saying he's useful. He was a great hostage. See, it was calm under the situation. And, you know, I mean, he knew all the cards. I mean,
there you have it, folks. He was a good hostage. I think Big Boy Sama has a little crush.
No. I don't think we can judge a person of a few or one action if they're smart or not. Because let's be honest, he's quite tactical. he knew to shut up when Kaname was talking. He already had a plan in order to successfully get rid of Wang, which also included get rid of himself, but so be it.
He wouldn't have successfully done anything because Wang would have just teleported out of it. And also, he's underestimated everyone he's come across so far. He underestimated the Sui Sota character, and he went inside the shop to retrieve a phone that was clearly a trap. He even was like, oh, this could be a trap, and still just walked into it, not bothering to really think about what he was doing. He let Kaname go because he thought he wasn't worth his time. He could have ended up getting killed by Kaname in the end. He's underestimated everyone.
But is it the fact that he's still here, still alive, still surviving, still moving forward, a testament to what intelligence in a real sort of Darwin scenario is? Doesn't matter why you get there, as long as you get there.
No. Although Kaname would probably agree with you, you know, he did pass on Rain's thoughts when Rain said to him, you know, just survive, even if that means running out the clock. And he basically said the same thing during that exchange with Wang to Rouge.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was basically like just passing the torch. And I also wonder, like, why Rouge even said, like, stay out of it, Kaname, but then sat back and listened. Do you think that he was curious about what Kaname was doing?
No. I think he has done what every other person in Kaname's clan has done, which is basically put all their eggs and faith inside Kaname. Because every time Kaname says something or does something, he, for some reason, this might be another power that he inspires so much loyalty and has so much charisma. But for some reason, everyone in that clan seems to be like, yep, Kaname, cool, I'm down. Whatever it is, I'm down, bro.
So we've got Kaname here, just half-heartedly starting a war with the Eighth.
Yeah, let's talk about how very detrimental I think that is to the survival of the clan.
You think so?
Yeah.
Which clan? Yeah, the Eighth?
No, I'm sorry. I know Kaname is hard, but he's not Eighth hard. Wang goes in, the people goes in. Like, I don't see that winning. I think that they'll come to some sort of resolution in the end, because firepower he does not have.
No, I completely disagree. Like, they're setting us up. No, I'm sorry, I know, but
Mommy?
I didn't think he was going to be able to. I didn't really think they were going to win the event, to be honest. I didn't. I know they were really smart, and I thought they had a really great plan, but I just wasn't sure how that was going to shake down. But I think that they're going to be able to beat the Eighth.
All right, guys, let us know, because I'm team, they don't beat the Eighth, they do some negotiation stuff. And I'm guessing Ruka's team, they're going to beat the Eighth. What's your one condition? Are you saying that they're going to obliterate the Eighth, take out Wang and all of that? Or are you saying that they're just going to dominate and make him disperse?
I'm saying that Wang has to die. He does not seem like the kind of person that is going to let a grudge go. He says that he works on a take and take basis.
That's true.
He has no middle ground. He said he does not negotiate. And now that he's been tricked by Kaname, he was publicly embarrassed in front of his whole clan. There's no way he is going to ever come to an agreement with Kaname. Like, there's just no way.
Yeah, I'm still team negotiate here, so
nope.
Put in hashtag team negotiate or hashtag team murder Wang.
What was that woman's name? The one with the cat mask. I don't even know if they mentioned her name,
but
she was fighting with Danjo, wasn't she?
Yeah.
And at the time, we didn't know who either of them were. So she was fighting with Danjo, and she's the only person who bet on Kaname to win.
Yeah.
Why did she bet on Kaname instead of like the top players? We had two top players in this game that were both doing really, really well.
Yeah.
Shuka and Wang.
But I think you forget one thing. Kaname is a top player. He's just new. He's still a top player. First of all, his power is materializing stuff out of thin air. Second of all, he's the first person to tag Shuka. Third of all, he has he had a fight with a guy, didn't kill him, but won the points by threatening his phone. His ingenuity and his abilities are out there. And he beat the florist while almost dead on his feet. Okay, but he still won.
I call that a draw.
Nah, he won, fam.
Well,
nah, he won.
Guys, I wouldn't say
he won.
I wouldn't say that he's a top player because we don't know what being a top player means. Is it how many points you have? Is it how many matches you've won? What exactly makes you a top player? So I'm only going off of what the Watcher class said, and they basically said that Xiuka was basically a top player. She was the top player in the region, and they also spoke about Wang being a top player as well. So I'm just going to go on that only.
Well, he has got a 100% win record, I'm just saying.
That is true. So he's up there. Game Master, please. Let's go, Game Master!
Who the hell is the Game Master?
He said he built the interface, but not the game. And he seems really excited about Kaname in general. Like, he seemed kind of excited on the phone.
My guy said he is not God. He's just a stand-in.
Sounds like something you would say.
That's true, but I am Big Boy Sama.
Yeah.
He is the Game Master. So is he like a Dungeon Master scenario where he controls the quests and what the players do and alters the game in that way? Or is he sort of like a Puppet Master where he's making stuff happen the way he wants to happen? Or is he one of those MMO creators that just go, build it, have fun, let's update, click?
No, I don't think that he is. He was watching extremely closely. As soon as Kaname picked up the phone, it rang. So he was watching very, very closely. And he's the one that actually gives people the names of their sigils. We've heard Rain talk about this Game Master before.
Yeah.
We've heard about him, so he's very much present. He also said that he's the one that grants the wishes, and he mentioned wishes that he had given to other people in the past. And what I found really, really interesting was the fact that he said that he gave someone an insurance company. So maybe we were debating how on earth the florist would have an insurance policy, because a normal insurance policy just doesn't work like that. They're not going to pay out millions and millions like that.
No way.
Under suspicious circumstances. It's just not going to happen.
Not even.
So how does this insurance company work? Because obviously it's a for-profit in some sort of way. Are they inviting people to Darwin's game and asking them to fulfill contracts and then betting on them?
Well, I don't think it needs to be that insidious. I mean, if you're trying to do like an insurance company for a game like this, surely it's a case where people will put points away every month and then get paid their points back. Because what, 10 points equals what, 740 quid or something like that. 10 points is quite a lot of money. So say you put in away 50 points every single day or every single week or so on and so forth, and they act like a holding place, you just get paid that to your next of kin when you die.
And what are they going to get out of something like that? And not only what are they going to get out of it, who told you that you're going to be able to make that many points in a day? Like, this is Darwin's game.
Darwin's game.
We're not quite sure how the points actually work, because after Kaname's match with Banda, he got 10 points.
Yeah.
But after his match with Xiuka, he got like 639 points or something like that. We have no idea how many points he got from any of his other matches. It seems to vary. We don't even know how many points you get from anything. So how is that going to work?
Well, you just get money back. You take money off the top, innit?
He had 300 million to give to his daughter in his insurance policy. How many points really are you going to be able to save to make that amount of money?
But remember, he was an ambush predator. He killed a lot of people. So he's probably got a lot of points, bro.
True, I guess. And you just
as the insurance company, you go, cool, you pay this, I take this, your family gets X. That's it.
Okay. I can't really disagree with that, can I?
Yeah.
So Darwin's game can be completed.
Yes, like, so we've had the first indication that there is an end to this.
Yeah, and the Game Master wants it to be completed.
Yeah, he seemed very towards that line of thinking.
And spoiler warning, if you guys read ReZero, the light novel, cover your ears for like a couple seconds. So it kind of reminded me of Echidona with her experimental grounds, the way she wanted it to be clocked. Basically, she wanted it to be won by somebody.
Yeah, it's a very similar sort of situation, but difference being over here is life and death and money.
Yeah, and he also said that the system can be destroyed. if the system is destroyed and he is destroyed, the game basically ends. And that kind of reminded me of like Psycho Pass, when the only way to sort of figure it out was to destroy the system from its core.
And like, let's be honest, if the game is destroyed, does that mean all the sigils go away?
Well, I don't think it would. I think that if you've learned your sigil, you won't lose it, because Kaname said that he knew it from the day he was born. That means that everyone has a sigil. We were talking about this universe possibly being a strange universe where everyone has these abilities inside them, and it just needs to be sort of awakened. So I think once it's awakened, there's no taking it back.
Now, he's talking to the Game Master. He has a wish that he's supposed to get. He makes the wish, but we don't know what it is. But he wanted to talk about protecting people from joining the game.
Yeah.
And, you know, preventing people from joining the game. How does that sound like to you?
Sounds like a wasted wish.
Am I right?
Like, it really does. So what is he going to do? Like, have a warning on the game? Because if I saw, like, a warning on the game, I would think that's a joke. Like, I would still download it. I would still play.
I mean, we got warnings on cigarettes, and, yeah, people still buy them.
That's true. And they have gruesome pictures of people's innards, and that still doesn't stop anyone. He got the Fire God of Iron. So, Big Boy Samma, have got anything to say?
I don't know what you're talking about.
So, me calling him a god this whole time is validated.
Ruka was right.
Oh my god. The Game Master said that the name was a gift. What exactly does that mean? Like, does naming the sigil give him extra powers? He was told that it was a super rare sigil. And then the name is rare as well.
Yeah, I mean, is it a nod to like anime such as Bleach, where knowing the name of your swords gave you more powers?
Oh.
Like your Bankai and your Zanpakuto and all sorts.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's quite a nice way of bringing back the traditional anime with the more modern and new. I like it. I like that twist, to be fair.
Bleach isn't that old.
Bleach is old, fam. It's part of the big three, and it's the shortest one.
Shuka wants to wipe out the eighth, but I don't think that was a surprise to anyone.
Shuka wants to wipe out the fly in the room that buzzed on her hair by accident. Shuka is all about that kill life, and that's great. But I don't think that their clan can take on the eight right now. Do you?
Like I said, I don't think it's going to be a problem.
Wow, really?
But they're going to have to add a couple members to their clan. I wonder how big they're going to allow their clan to get. With Kaname's notoriety, he's done so much so quickly. He's made himself such a target, but he's also made his clan something that people are going to want to flock to, I think.
You know what? Yeah, I agree with that.
And can we please put some clothes on Sui? She's like, how old is she supposed to be? Like 10?
Yeah.
Why is she naked? Like, put some clothes on her.
Anime.
They're trying to make her, like, sexy, and it's gross.
Yeah, it's very gross. Very gross.
Okay, hear me out. I know this is going to be probably a bit controversial.
As opposed to a game about killing each other and gaining points.
Yeah.
Okay, go on.
Is Rain going to invite the florist's daughter to the game?
What?
I know. I said it was controversial. It's just that the girl seems to be ill enough to be in this hospital for an extended period of time, and we haven't seen any family members around the girl. Like, we've seen her quite a few times, but we haven't seen a mother figure. We haven't seen any siblings or any other family members. She seems to be alone. Yeah, she's got 300 million, but she doesn't have anyone to look after her. And Rain left her business card, told her her game name of the analyst, and told her to seek her out if she wanted to know any information about her dad. It feels like it's setting it up for maybe she's gonna join the game. If Rain tells her anything about the game or about her dad's death, she's gonna have to be in D game.
Well, how about this for a take? And I know it's a bit deep, but it does fall into the whole Darwin part of this game.
Mm.
Rain makes money.
Yeah.
This girl just got 300 million.
No, you're not going to say.
No, let me finish. This girl just got 300 million. Rain sells info. She's about to sell this girl some info she might need. That's it.
Oh,
it's a transaction,
God.
Bro. Gotta eat to live, bro. Gotta make money to eat, bro. That's it. Rain is about that life, making that money, constant paper.
Guys, I don't know who is worse in this episode, me or Big Boy Sama. We just got introduced to Danjo properly and Kaide, the healer.
The healer?
She said she healed, well, she didn't say it, but it was said that she healed Rouge's arm. Like, she healed him. She could reattach his arm, like...
Yeah, or did she grow it? Who knows?
How far does her healing go? Because that's a sick person to have in your team. Danjo's team is looking real strong right now.
I mean, I can understand why, like, Kaname definitely wants to be, like, allied with them.
Yeah, I mean, Danjo's clan cleaned up with two members of their clan and got enough rings for every single member of their clan, and he said they had 26 members.
78 rings. Wow. With just two people.
Mm.
And then they didn't even bother go looking for the end game. They just chilled.
Yeah, a lot of people seem to have done that though. They just got enough rings for what they needed and they just left everybody else to fight for the end game.
Yeah, leave the overachievers to their overachieving ways. It's crazy. I mean, they're about to have a fight. Two clan members, clan leaders, sorry. And this is probably a fight where Danjo will see whether it's even beneficial being partnered up with the clan.
Yeah, that's what he did say. Who do you think's gonna win? Sorry, go on, say what he was gonna say.
No, it's because basically a clan alliance works two ways, doesn't it? When you need help, they come help you, but when they need help, they need to be able to trust that you can actually help them. And so therefore this fight is gonna see whether he feels that he can be helped in a pinch. But you're right. Who do you think is gonna win? I'm asking you because I feel like my answer is controversial.
I think Danjo's gonna win.
Yeah, so do I.
I mean, he said that he could win against a tank if it was one on one, like, and he said it like it was really nothing.
A one on one tank fight. Do you think Kaname could take on a tank? No, fam.
And we don't know what Danjo's sigil is either. And also, we heard
Inukai.
He was like, no, you can't fight with him. Like, you can't. Do this. I don't think it's going to be pretty. Kaname's going to get knocked around a little bit.
Do you think Kaname looked really, really excited to fight?
Yeah. He gets that look in his face when he's about to trick someone. So I think that he's got a few tricks up his sleeve. He usually, like, he did that look with the florist when he threw the grenade, but really he had a flashbang and he was, like, smiling. He did the same when he fought
Inukai
and kneed him in the face and took his phone. He's got that look on his face again, so I think it's going to be a really good fight, but I still think he's going to lose.
Yeah, I agree. He's lost this one.
So maybe they'll be together in the future, like they'll team up in the future, but it's probably not on the cards for him right now.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Unless, it depends what Danjo's expecting, because he probably isn't expecting Kaname to win anyway, so maybe he's judging off different things. Anyway, guys, that's it from us.
Don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe.
Peace.